Stilson, I've often thought his name was derived as a combination of Still and Nixon, which I think is part of the perspective that Steve King was applying then in the 1970s, where we had just suffered through the end game of the Nixon presidency at about the time that he was writing the book, and had gone through another cycle of corruption, power, lies, all those things that we associate now all too frequently with politics.
The visions did get longer as the film progressed. They were flashes, obviously, at the beginning, until when the theme was bigger, with Stilson, the presidential candidate, it was a whole scene.
The lead character, Chris Walken, he has this psychic power to see into the future. And when I meet him at a campaign rally, he shakes my hand, and with the contact, he gets a vision of the future. And that's where this incident takes place, in the future, where I've become president of the United States, and I decide to push the button and start World War III and end the world, literally.
My destiny.
Of course, the movie is very subversive in a way, because you can see it as an apology for political assassination. And if you really look at it from a distance, both the book and the movie are suggesting that under certain circumstances, assassination is justified, that a man alone, based on his visions, could be justified in assassinating a successful politician. That's a fairly heavy thing to suggest, and it means, once again, for it to work in the movie, that we have to believe that what Johnny sees is true. That's another reason that I wanted to see it from his point of view, because I wanted the audience to feel that it was justified, and then when the movie was over, to say, wow, I really wanted him to shoot this man, but I wanted the audience to be complicit in the assassination attempt. And of course, he needed an opponent who was also grandiose. And that was, of course, the Martin Sheen character, Stilson, a man who is a rabble-rouser and a dangerous politician. But speaking of Martin Sheen's performance as Greg Stilson, I will defend that as not being over the top.
Now you put your goddamn hand on that scanning screen, or I'll hack it off and put it on for you!
Not being a caricature or a cartoon, but as being accurate in terms of the way certain politicians present themselves. I think Stilson is a credible character. Unfortunately, he is not a cartoon who is too absurd to be real. He is very real.
And most importantly, I need your money.
God bless, Roger. I'll be seeing
you. You have only to wake up of a given morning and pick up a newspaper, and you have to wonder what kind of world we're living in. We're a drug culture. We've got a higher percent of divorce than any country in the world. We have interests in every conceivable part of the world. We're so spread thin, and yet we're asked to live normal lives under the threat of nuclear annihilation. Everybody on the globe. So you have to wonder what is sane and what is not sane. I think you have to have a connection with a far more important reality than what's going on here. You have to find in other people that quality which you best seek in yourself, the very best in you. Not project the worst on others and expect the worst. You have to really expect the best, because times are so anxiety-ridden and so precarious that maintaining one's sanity can be a day-to-day job. I've often felt that acting was above all good therapy, because it gives the actor a license, as it were, to deal in areas that ordinarily he would be arrested for. So I think that in large measure it's the creativity that's thwarted that causes serious problems in the society.
The question was, what did Greg Stilson do to end his career? What happened? He had to do some really terrible, obviously cowardly thing to end his career, because Johnny doesn't shoot him, he escapes. Johnny instead gets shot, but somehow Stilson's career is going to be over. And of course, he commits suicide. We see that in the future he will commit suicide. What makes him do that? What he did was he grabbed a baby and held it up to protect himself so that he wouldn't get shot. Something that if it did appear on the cover of Newsweek, as you see in Johnny's flash forward to the future, would end a politician's career.
Give me him! Don't!
He in the original novel, it was just a child from the audience. You know, he grabbed someone, you know, whoever was handy. In the motion picture, the child is actually the child, of course, of John Smith's beloved. And it makes the scene even more powerful.
I thought, well, of course she has to be there at the finale, and why not bring her baby? And so we had to hustle around and find this baby. And like the first baby, this baby was kind of cranky. So the baby is always crying.
Just a side note, the kid who takes the photographs is the only member of the Sheen family who hasn't been an actor. He was there visiting his dad, Martin Sheen, and David said, here, you take the pictures. So he takes the Newsweek photo. When Martin Sheen's character, Greg Stilson, is prevented from winning the primary, we had a two-walled motel room. It was just him on a bed with a night table, and I think we just put black fabric in the background and kept it very stark, put the gun under his chin, cut to the Newsweek, and David had a handful of blood, and splashed it on.
Now, in the novel, the closure that Sarah receives is different in its depiction, although the same emotionally, and she has a closure through a scene where she goes to visit John Smith's grave, and she suddenly feels a touch on her shoulder, but there's no one there, and she realizes in her heart, or at least believes that it's Johnny, and says to herself, same old Johnny.
Goodbye.
I love you.
The ending was a big set piece, and it went from pretty wide things to basically a love story between the two of them, or the return of the love story. The resolution of the love story, it was quite small, and it was personal, and it ended that way. There was an alternative, at least one alternative ending, that would possibly have tidied up a few things for the audience, which ultimately we didn't think was necessary.
With The Dead Zone, I think there was the feeling that there should be some coda to it, some denouement, something that took the pressure off the audience, the emotional pressure off the audience, so that you'd have a bit of a chance to breathe, to see Sarah, what her life was like afterwards, that she, of course, had recovered from his death, that she has her baby. But it just seemed to diminish the movie by doing that, rather than enhancing it, by making it fuller. The power of that moment, it was as though it just felt like that was where the movie should end.
David has an ability to hold back everyone's emotions and then grab you by a particular organ you hadn't thought of. In this case, I think it was the first time he'd reached for the heart rather than the throat.
One of the interesting things about the combination of Stephen King and David Cronenberg in The Dead Zone is that it's not really a horror movie. But that combination was delivering something else. And it's interesting because the visuals of the film are very much attuned to that, and the music is very much attuned to that. Michael Kamen's score is a very idyllic score. It's a brilliant background score for that particular film. And it never once indulges those kinds of tropes that we tend to hear in horror film scores. Instead, it very much stands on its own and serves as an emotional backdrop for the visuals that Cronenberg delivers.
You're finished.
I had done every original score up to that point with Howard Shore, but there were reasons why he could not do the score for The Dead Zone. I wanted him to. There were scheduling problems, but the suggestion was that we use Michael Kamen. And I met Michael, and I loved him immediately. It was a wonderful experience. Michael really understood that loneliness, that emotion, the sadness, the bittersweetness of the movie.
Can teachers be expelled for kissing in the hallway?
They get fired.
Thank God it's Friday.
Of course, he's a fine composer, but I think everybody relaxed a bit when they heard the score because it worked really well, and it was very atmospheric.
And he really reflected that beautifully in the score that he did, also very orchestral. So it was really, ultimately, it was not a disaster on any level, but really a wonderful experience.
I think a lot of people came to that film wondering, what is David Cronenberg going to do to The Dead Zone to make it his own? He took a very subdued approach, I thought. It has that kind of clinical, cold feeling that his films sometimes have, a detached observation that I think is a good thing because we don't get drawn in so much to sort of the pathos of Johnny Smith's situation. We're seeing it with a bit more perspective and a bit more uncertainty. Even though we feel very strongly for him, we still have that distance that we're able to assess what's going on, why it's happening.
Dear Sarah, this is a hard letter to write, so I'll try to make it short.
Well, I didn't make that many movies, so they all sort of stand out. But this one I really, really did like, and I love Chris. And I thought, oh, good, they're going to do something nice with the film on DVD, and I liked the idea. I think the film holds up. I've gotten over the years a lot of fan mail, and they always mention Dead Zone, so I think it's nice.
The Dead Zone is really the past, is everything that John Smith has lost in his coma, those years that have gone by. And finally, the book itself talks about the Dead Zone really as being the world of the dead, that place where memories go, memories of people who we loved, who now passed on. They're now sort of in this Dead Zone where they're still alive, but in our memories.
In a way, the Dead Zone, the movie, is a Dead Zone for me because Deborah Hill has died, Jeffrey Baum has died, Michael Kamen, several of the actors, several members of the crew, all died young. So it's a kind of a sad thing, in a way, for me to watch the movie again, remembering all these people who are gone now. But it is in keeping with the tone of the movie, which, as I said, is basically about loss.
Goodbye.